What about the myth, Matt, that porn empowers women? That's a fairly pervasive myth, I would say.
Yeah, this is a myth that it's nice to believe, because if I'm the sort of person who likes to stimulate myself to pictures of people being abused on a screen for payment, it's very helpful if I can also tell myself that not only am I a gentleman, but that I'm contributing to the flourishing of women all around the world or something. But that's just absolute nonsense. There's nothing liberating about choosing to be a sex object. I would put it this way. Being cool about being degraded doesn't make being degraded any more cool. And so someone can tell you that they find this liberating, but what else would they say? This is their means of income at the moment. But speak to that woman 5 years after she's got out of the industry, and I promise you it's a different story. So I have a podcast called Love People Use Things, and just the other week I interviewed a porn star for an hour about what it was like and why she ended up getting out. And she agreed with me, because I've worked alongside of several people who've been in the porn industry. She's like, I can't tell you one woman who didn't suffer some serious form of neglect or abuse as a child. That's just the boring narrative that they'll all tell you. This idea that you have a healthy life and that you end up getting into it, I think it's just a fiction that we have to tell ourselves. And, you know, I'm a fan of some of the things Friedrich Nietzsche said. He had this notion of resentiment. And the idea with that, he says, is when you feel yourself impotent to attain a particular good, you demonize the good. You turn the virtue into a vice and the vice into a virtue. So if I cannot control myself, well, I have two options. I either say I'm weak, or I look to people like Matt Fratt and say, you're a frigid, uptight, anti-sex prude. And it's a lot easier to do that because I don't have to change. I have to demonize chastity, right? Demonize people who are opposed to pornography. And that's, I think, what we're seeing when you hear people say porn's liberating to women. I mean, what woman are you talking about? The one in the industry? The wives, ask them if they feel empowered by their husband's porn use. Your daughters, do they feel empowered at having to live up now to these apparent standards that they feel they have to live up to? Which woman in particular do you feel is being empowered by this? I think it's just nonsense.
So this is a pervasive myth, because if you have Dear Abby saying that pornography can actually be okay, it can actually help you with sexual intimacy, she's tacitly endorsing something that is demeaning to women in general.
Right. Demeaning to women, demeaning to men. Because I think at the heart of every man is the desire to be a protector, and porn turns him into a predator. Maybe we could say at the bottom of the desire every woman is a desire to be treasured, but porn turns her into a target. And so neither of us get what we want. It promises us, like most sin does, something good, you know. You think, well, I'll go to porn and I'll be excited, but we become bored. Or you go in order to become free to do whatever you want and you become enslaved. Or you go for, for adult entertainment, you become increasingly juvenile. I think ask anybody who's been struggling with this for any length of time, have you ever met an addict who you found interesting? I mean, any interesting person you've ever met, someone you're like, wow, this person seems to have like a broad and deep interior life. That's not a person who's hooked on drugs, you know. And again, I mean, I've got about 40 pages in the back of the porn myth, I think, that tries to document these studies to show that this isn't just my thought, that this is what the sciences are finding.